Part-Time UFO is a physics-based puzzle game from a few years back, depicting the escapades of a tiny saucer alien stranded on Earth. With the power of nothing but its retractable claw and an insatiable drive to be helpful, the cosmic visitor takes upon all manner of odd jobs, mostly including a lot of stuff that needs moving around. It's the latest creation from the good folks at HAL Laboratory. You know, the Kirby guys. And just like Uncle Sakurai's pet project, Anime Swordfighter Bros, so too is Part-Time UFO absolutely packed with different things to do. I mean, you can pick up an orange and put it in a cart, or you can pick up a stuffed toy and put it in a box, or you can pick up a fishy and put it in a boat. You can also pick up some pancakes and stack them up, or you can dangle some poor hapless high school lass by their ankles and watch them twitch in horror as they wait for their turn to get probed. Why on earth am I playing this? Well, a couple of reasons. Like most video games worth of my time, Part-Time UFO holds two key factors: appealing gameplay loop and a charming presentation. Let's start with the more video gamey of the two. The basic premise of each job is to scurry objects across the tiny levels and place them neatly on a target zone. Sometimes it's as simple as loading up a truck with the season's harvest, other times the player is expected to exert more finesse, such as when putting together museum exhibits or building temples. The main challenge arises from the game's physics engine. Each object has real weight based on their shape and size, swaying upon the UFO's claw like a pendulum according to the player's movements. The feel of mass and inertia is pretty much as one might expect, even if a tad simplified for the sake of the pick-up and play design. It's actually pretty cool and satisfying to play around with the physics, tossing and tackling things, balancing everything, and getting the wobbly pile of whatever to stand just right. The key to success is taking one's time, nice and easy, float like a feather. It's like building a house of cards, you can't rush it. Despite the seemingly simple mechanics and goal, picking stuff up and placing them a couple paces aside, the game has a surprising amount of, well, I can't exactly say complexity. However, the developers did manage to squeeze a lot of mileage out of the idea. The game starts with exceedingly effortless jobs. Bring stuff from point A to point B, stack them up nicely on the smallish target zone, go home. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. After the tutorial-esque missions, the game quickly moves on to more interesting scenarios. The target zone may float upon water, making careful balancing even more important. Other jobs include hazards, such as ninjas that try to halt the player's progress. A couple of the game's best missions, far as I care, task the player with arranging a pile of Tetris pieces inside a grid, offering a nice brain teaser in addition to the usual stacking of stuff. At the end of each mission, the player is gifted money for a job well done, as well as graded on their performance with a trio of medals. Each medal is acquired by completing a special task amidst the toiling. The most common is simply completing the mission under a time limit. Others include things like finding secret objects from the environment, taking no hits from hazards, or stacking objects in a specific way. The game incentivizes going after these medals by unlocking further missions once the player collects enough. There aren't really any stinkers in the selection of missions. What the game does have, however, is a couple of overarching design hiccups. But these are minor stuff, mind you. Sometimes the game area feels vertically cramped, like I hit the ceiling just a tad too soon. It becomes annoying in missions that have high structures to build, and I can just barely squeeze myself inside the narrow gap with my cargo. It's not a big issue, but it threw me off a bit. Also, the hints for the medals are given in the form of pictures. Most of them are fine and easy to understand, but a couple of them are a bit too vague for my liking. It becomes a case of trial and error to figure out what exactly the game wants. I don't think it would have ruined the presentation or anything to simply have a text blurb explaining the optional missions. Aside from that, I'd call the difficulty curve mellow. Simply completing the job is rarely a demanding task, and all the stuff that's even remotely challenging is made optional. Trying to go for the trio of medals in each level, as well as completing the remixed versions of the levels that are unlocked after the fact. And even then, the tasks are simple enough. Only a couple of the levels stand out as harrowingly tricky. It's that very Nintendo-like game design philosophy. Make the game easy enough so that people can jump right in and get a sense of accomplishment, but keep it just demanding enough so that folks won't fall asleep at the wheel. Or joystick. And as we all know, every game is made more fun with a second player to play with. You can look it up, it's a scientific fact. So, let's invite a friend over and tackle the tasks as a duo. So what you wanna do today?
Let's have a fashion show!
Well, alright then. So it feels kinda redundant to even say it at this point, but this game is absolutely adorable.
Totally. Kirby games have some adorable enemies, and one of them is the enigmatic UFO. The moment I saw part-time UFO, I immediately recognized that the cute little creature has its own game now. You can spot Hal's style and design miles away. Games like Kirby and Box Boy are treasure troves of charm. They are built on simple and fun ideas, a pink puffball sucking up enemies or a sentient box summoning even more boxes. The core gameplay is easy to grasp right away, with lots of room for expansion and optional challenge. They are made to be enjoyed by all. The characters are equally inviting. The heroes themselves are just simple shapes, yet they are brimming with personality. Oftentimes less is more. UFO continues this legacy. Both Kirby and Kyuubi even make cameos. Cute characters like this simply melt my heart. And just look at UFO's eyes. Those are the eyes of a true hero. It looks like it can take on anything and everything. Bring it on. I probably have some kind of weakness to adorable creatures with deadpan stares. I wanna give it a hug. Also, the little gestures and struggled expressions make it real relatable. It's such a tiny hard worker. Oversized hook definitely multiplies the cuteness factor, and you can even dress it up into various costumes while listening to the jamming beats. And the second player's costumes are all different, so I get double sets of costumes. Glorious! But the ultimate part that makes me go totally aww is the music. The entire soundtrack is built around a single joyful leitmotiv. They repeat the Japanese title, Hataraku UFO, in every single song, and every time I hear it, I can stop myself from singing along. It's way too adorable that UFO has its own theme song. It's like a Saturday morning cartoon. Even though the motif is repeated hundreds of times while playing the game, it never gets tiresome. The melody fits every stage perfectly. The stage design itself is also a wonderful blast of colors and wacky situations. It leaves me on such a good mood. It's a wholesome, sensuous experience. I don't need to take my vitamins anymore. Part-time UFO gives me all the energy I need.
As for the co-op aspect of the game, it works. Yeah, there's not much more to say about it. The game isn't actually balanced around co-op, so the second player is purely a boost. You can complete tasks twice as fast with two claws instead of one. Or at least that's what my first grade teacher told me. Just be careful not to smack each other as you fly by. It makes an enjoyable experience that bit more precious. Shared joy is a double joy. but for my money, the absolute best content of the game comes in the form of a side mode, Tower of Infinity. As you might guess from the name, the goal here is to put those stacking skills to the ultimate test and see just how high you can make your pile of crap go. There's no room to rush here, each move has to be planned. It's more important to build a solid foundation and keep the playing field as wide and level as possible, rather than shooting for the sky straight away. It's not easy, especially since the player has no idea what items the game will randomize for them next. It's the most methodic, challenging, and satisfying the game gets. It's a constant nail-biter, as any mishap can cause all your hard work falling to pieces. Whenever I fail, and I do fail, a lot, it's always that certain kind of irritation where I go, alright, just once more, let's go. And even here, the charming soundtrack enhances the experience. The beginning of the journey is backed up by a bobbing tune, like the game is telling the player to just have fun and do their best. Higher up, as the Tower of Babel out of Random Chunk keeps climbing, the music fades into foreboding ambience, the sound of blistering wind. And as the player finally rises above the clouds, a triumphant tune arises to greet them. At that moment, when I've gotten into a nice groove with the stacking, I'm in the zone, the tower keeps growing, nothing can stop me now, and the song kicks in like the game is tipping its hat and saying, "You did good, Lobster Boy, you did good." It feels like flying over the moon. The song is honestly really beautiful, and kinda emotional, probably the best tune on the entire soundtrack. Fun is something that resides in the area between frustration and boredom, and as far as I see it, the game fits consistently within the fun category. Despite our praise for the game, it does fall a tad short in certain aspects. Quite literally, in fact. Each level takes only a couple of minutes to fully complete, and the entire game is done and dusted in a handful of hours. It was originally released as a mobile game, and it's meant to be a bite-sized experience, but the briefness may still leave many, myself included, wanting more. Especially considering the 10 € asking price on Switch. It's a bit steep for only a few hours of entertainment. A while ago, I said that the developers got a lot of mileage out of the mechanics. That is to say, I feel like they didn't push the gameplay quite as far as I would have liked. They have all the assets, nothing would have kept them from crafting a couple of more of those block puzzles, or further harder variants of any of the other level types. There's a good base for expansion, and a couple more challenges would have been greatly appreciated. The game also teases a few new mechanics right at the end. The final levels introduce combat mechanics to the gameplay soup, and that extra spice of whacking away enemies with their comrades is enjoyably dumb fun for what it is. The game even musters a single boss fight to top it all off. Furthermore, after the credits roll, the game throws a small dungeon crawling level at the player, as a final bonus. It's the largest and frankly the most complex level of the game. It's over in a flash, but the multiple chambers, small puzzles, and hidden treasures to find give a taste of what part-time UFO could be. To have all of these elements realized, and then do close to nothing with them, just seems like kind of a waste. I'd love to play a full-blown Metroidvania adventure as this adorable little saucer. Or maybe some kind of minigame collection party game type of deal. There's plenty more potential waiting to be tapped here. It's sort of telling that my biggest criticism of the game boils down to the fact that there isn't more of it. Part-Time UFO is an enjoyable, albeit modest game. It knows what it wants to do, and does so effortlessly. It's a pure video game in the classic sense of the word. There's no pretense, no cynicism. It doesn't chase trends, it's not trying to be the next huge thing. It just kinda hangs around, doing its own thing. With simple gameplay, the cuteness, the quirkiness, it's just solid fun and a relaxing experience. The feel of the game is perfectly encapsulated by the title screen, the titular alien just chilling in its tiny apartment. No rush, no fuss. It's real comfy, the kind of living I can get behind. All the game wishes to do is to entertain the player for a wee while, and maybe make them smile every now and then. And when I play the game, I do find myself grinning an awful lot. The Kirby guys have a great new title under their belt. Now let's hope for a sequel. Thanks for watching. Leave a like, thoughts in the comment section, and subscribe for more stuff. You know how it works. Take care, everyone, and I'll see you all in the next one.